l'aspettavano così.
Perché credo in quello che dico.
Questo e basta?
Sì.
Giussani ha generato un popolo e io faccio parte di questo popolo.
L'avvenimento in cui Dio entra nella nostra esistenza e tutti, colpiti da una curiosità, sospendono per un istante l'ora e guardano dalla parte da cui viene il grido.
L'aspettavano così.
Perché credo in quello che dico.
Questo e basta?
Sì.
Don Giussani ha generato un popolo e io faccio parte di questo popolo.
L'avvenimento in cui Dio entra nella nostra esistenza. Sospendono per un istante l'ora e guardano dalla parte da cui viene il grido.
Civiltà dell'amore, fratelli e sorelle, costruite senza stancarvi mai questa civiltà. Lavorate per questo, pregate per questo, soffrite per questo.
Good morning and welcome to this meeting entitled Democracy and Truth. We have Giuliano Amato, the president of the Italian Constitutional Court, with us, and we would like to thank him for being here. I would like to start with a couple of preliminary remarks. And I would like then to ask the president of the court to comment on them. I have four requests, four questions basically. One concerns democracy and truth, that basically starts from the title of the meeting, which is very ambitious. It connects democracy with the truth, with the hope that democratic life stems from the research for freedom. And that's basically, that refers from the fact that democratic life should start from an ideal commitment by political party, that the pursuit of self-interest does not translate into the patronage-style defense of parts of the population. Just think about the fact that many acts have been approved over the past few years to defend specific interests and not the common good. If we have a huge public debt, that's not because we spent a lot of money in the field of health or in education. It's quite the opposite. And this ideal commitment has very much to do with what Prime Minister Mario Draghi said in on the occasion of his last speech in the Senate. Italy is strong when united. We are strong, not with rhetoric. We are strong if we are pluralistic, if we sacrifice our own peculiar interest to the general interest. So pluralism is not against this search for truth. It's quite the opposite. When we search for truth, the other party is quite positive about this. There was a paper written, there was a statement by Don Julian Caron on the paper La Repubblica, who said that this is a common good. So the no confidence vote of the Draghi government shows that there can be a peculiar, particular interest which in a very difficult time replaces the common interest. Abstentionism, the fact that we go from 30% in consensus to, let's say, 10%, shows that all of this has repercussions on the population. So the first question is, how is it possible that legitimate differences in positions that are typical of a democratic and pluralist society contribute to the creation of a common good that is made up of tangible responses to citizens? In other words, linking the democracy to the search for truth, is this linked to pluralism? And then there's a second question that concerns elections and subsidiarity. It is rightly asserted that it is necessary to go back to the electors, and to actually check what citizens want. But just think about this. Apparently, free elections take place also in autocratic regimes. It is a fact that in those regimes you have people who go to vote and they vote for their dictator because they are convinced of the person. When individuals are isolated, they can be influenced. There was a meeting on the 100th anniversary of Don Giussani's death, and it was said that Giussani's biggest insight is the idea that power, Zuppi mentioned this yesterday, commenting also what Pasolini had said, so this influences the person, it reduces desire, it reduces wishes, it lays the foundations for specific and particular interests. So elections and subsidiarity, why this dichotomy? In order for truly free elections to take place, it is necessary that individuals who are looking for freedom are not isolated. If you are isolated, you find it difficult to in a way, keep your own perspective. You need places in which the truth is corrected, in which the truth is educated, and in which the limits are educated, and in which forms of coexistence are built. Some years ago, in 2011, this is actually what we did. We had former President Napolitano, and there was an exhibition here at the meeting on subsidiarity, and that referred also to the setting up of democratic parties that are very much connected to these social realities. So in the individual, even if you're dealing with an illiterate individual, you still have an idea of democracy that would stand and that would oppose autocratic attempts. So this is a guarantee for democracy together with free elections. So my second question is, how can we give birth to democracy with these three elements? Elections, as well as places that provide education, proper education to individuals, the education for people in order to be free in their judgments. In TV talk shows, you have last time opinions expressed. And then there's a third point, social development. I've often said here at the Rimini meeting that this report on subsidiarity that we drafted with the Italian Statistical Office with these years has highlighted interesting aspects. So starting from the social welfare index, we have seen that whenever you are committed in social activities, you have an increase in employment, and there is a 0.1 to 0.7 ratio between the two elements, or there is an increase in cultural activities. Furthermore, there is a lower risk of poverty. In other words, the relationship between social commitment and subsidiarity is 0.91. And in our country, we have 375,000 entities of the third sector with over 4 million people employed in these entities. So there is a question that comes to my mind, and it's quite strange also in electoral times. Is there a link between democracy and this constructive commitment, engagement coming from the bottom up? We have lots of volunteers. We have good willing people, and this is a group of the population which is growing. And then a last question, what's the role of parliament? This is very much connected to this. You have parties who are linked to social realities. They discuss on the occasion of the congresses. They submit their thesis. And there are many topics being discussed. On the occasion of a previous meeting, President Amato said that within the parties, even issues like the aqueduct of peace were discussed. And then a third important aspect is that you have to wish, you have to decide whom you want to vote. The next elections are going to be elections in which candidates are going to be indicated and appointed by parties. This is not appropriate. And then parliament, why should we lose the legislative power? We're having only the judicial power and the executive power. Years ago, people were, it was said that actually parliament was particularly important. Parliament is a particularly rich institution. Many acts, many pieces of legislation have stemmed from collaborations in parliament. So these are the four main macro questions that I would like to pose to President Giuliano Amato. I would like him to answer them as well as to expand on them as much as he wishes. We believe that a personal life without a common social and political life is not a complete life. Thank you very much.
Funziona.
First of all, I would like to thank you all for participating here in this session. Unfortunately, the lights do not allow me to see very well how many people there are, but I can perceive that there's quite a large number of people. Thanks to Giorgio Vittadini for inviting me and for his questions. I would like to answer your questions by adopting a precise stance. The approach that I deliberately chose for this dialogue, for this conversation. My idea, my intention has been to gradually focus on the most important issue that we need to face, that is to say, the hold of democracies and the way in which they are suited to current challenges. And especially in difficult, challenging times, in the challenging times that lie ahead for our children and our grandchildren, in a hotter and hotter world, in a planet that is increasingly less livable for human beings. So democracy and livability, democracy and truth, sorry. This is a title that is full of promises and full of questions, and I, frankly speaking, do not believe that we're going, that we'll be able to answer them all. I would like to basically limit my answers only to the topic that I was referring to before. If you read literature, if you look at the titles of the many publications that carry the words democracy and truth, you find many ideas. The first idea that comes out is that in democracy, you always have to say the truth. Is this true? And your first answer is that yes, this might be the case because democracy is based on consensus. And if consensus is based on trust, if trust is trust between people who express solidarity one with the other, well, then truth is something that is irrenounceable. That's true, but only up to a limited extent. Because, for example, if I have the responsibility to govern, and if I know that in 4 days less commodities will be available in the supermarkets, well, probably it's appropriate that I do not say this immediately. Otherwise, I will induce the population to rush to the supermarket and buy everything. So there is a very slippery, so to say, rule that basically tells us that within certain boundaries, it might sometimes be appropriate not to tell the truth. But nobody who has ever written about democracy will give you an answer to your second question. Is democracy, has democracy the task to fight against lies? Of course, the answer has to be yes. Democracies cannot be based on lies. And this is something that everybody states. However, here too, we have to make things clear. There are many people who say, like Giorgio Vittadini said, that within a democracy there can be various truths. So truths and democracy. Democracy is a regime of freedom, and in a regime based on freedom, how possible it is, how compatible it is that you have several types of truths in a democracy. So first, you have the truth of facts. The truth of facts is what is really at risk today, according to some opinionists in democracies, because technology, I think it was Luciano Violante, in his publication on politics and lies, Luciano Violante stated that the technological postmodernism has replaced the true with the semile, vero semile, with the truthful. So, besides facts, you have sometimes opinions. These opinions take some bits of the truth, and this, of course, makes a reconstruction of the true fact not so sure. So when I was a young guy, when I started writing in the papers, when my first director of a paper, Lamberto Secchi, a very important journal, organized his new weekly magazine based on a slogan, that is to say, facts separated by opinions, because facts are facts. And then you may have your own opinion, but facts are facts. But apparently, all of this is no longer true. Apparently, opinions are part of a fact, and facts are part of opinions. And this, of course, makes reality less certain. And if this happens, how can you build consensus? I had these questions in mind. I've had these questions in mind for long. And this when a gentleman who inhabits the Kremlin came to the idea of invading the Ukraine. So on the part of Russia, no war. This is what his media stated. That was a special operation. And that special operation was justified by the consensus in favor of Russia in this separate land. Young people started being killed. They were doing the military service. They didn't even think that they would end up in a place where they could die. Their mothers were not told this. Their mothers were even denied the fact that their children were dying, because actually they were dealing with a special operation, and special operations do not create casualties. And those people who were trying to assert this truth got arrested in Russia. And so back then I wondered, at least here in Italy, in the West, this cannot happen. Probably we have, in a way, not depicted facts as they are, but there is no official truth that in a democracy can basically cannot be opposed to those who contest it. You may try to impose official truths on serious facts, on serious events in a democracy. Several years ago, there was a plane. This plane crashed in Ustica. And we still do not know what the truth is, what the truth was. But one thing is for sure, the imposed official realities that were attempted to be imposed were not accepted. So if you have doubts over the on the fact that you might prefer democracy over an autocratic regime, just think about this. And still, we also have press. We have the press, and this press can, in a way, shed light to those who want to deny facts. And that is because we have an independent judiciary. And in an independent, within an independent judiciary, you have judges who think with their own brain. And there is a system that has been envisaged and designed in such a way that its ultimate goal is to search for truth. Over the last few years, I have analyzed and assessed the pieces of legislation. And one of the types of acts, of pieces of legislation, that the Constitutional Court analyzed were those laws, those pieces of legislation according to which you can attribute negative consequences for individuals based not so much on their reality, but rather based on assumptions. This is not allowed. It is not allowed that you use an assumption that has not been previously assessed and checked to, in a way, bring someone to jail or implement a security measure against someone or, for example, deprive someone from sanction someone. I mean, you need a fact. This is the way we are structured. So, at least we know that official truths are not accepted in democracy. And of course, you should not be content with this, but this is still something that matters in today's world. Nobody can be arrested because they are saying the opposite. This is something that matters in the world. It matters in Russia, in Myanmar, as well as in many other countries. Let's go back to what we were talking about before, that is to say the fact that the reality based on facts in a democracy is sometimes easily aggressed and opposed, not so much by official realities, but by the non-truths, by the fact that sometimes you deny a fact because that's appropriate for you, that's convenient for you, or because you are defending ideological ideas, ideologies that you want to support. And because of these ideologies, you are tempted to deny. Hence, and this is something that we experienced also during the pandemic, hence internal divisions, polarized attitudes, and radicalized behaviors that make it so difficult to take decisions, to make decisions in a democracy. However, when we talk about reality, there are also other categories that need to be considered here. In other words, not so much only the dichotomy true-false, but also the dichotomy just-unjust, fair-unfair. Also with this dichotomy, we are able to question whether a fact is fair or unfair. So different categories, true, false, fair, unfair. These categories start approaching one to the other. And this leads me to address yet another sector, yet another aspect. There are challenges and perils to the certainties that we need. And these perils come not so much to technological postmodernism, but rather to relativism, to individualistic relativism. This relativism that has for decades contributed to, in a way, disrupt and disentangle the connective tissue of the connective fabric of our societies. And many facts have contributed to this. So, for example, our lives have become more and more individualized. When we went from the countryside and large, big families to urban life, and in the city, you ended up being alone, or you ended up living in a small household. So our lives have become more individualized in a society that, precisely because of this, was termed as a liquid society by Zygmunt Bauman. Then the end of big aggregating factors, the individual lives coincides with the end of the with the fact that big parties of the past lost their power to aggregate people together. So when they worked, and they did work for decades, parties were the only factor that contributed to the functioning of democracy, and this to the benefit of millions and millions of people. At the end of the 19th century, thanks to popular parties and thanks to socialist parties, the democracies that were that had been created for the habentes, for the elites, back then, these democracies were faced with the request for participation, with the request for sharing by the millions and millions of people who had been left outside because they were non-habentes. And this posed a big problem. The doors could not be left closed. However, how could have it been possible to bring together the needs and the expectations of millions and millions of human beings, and not only the interests and the needs of a restricted group of people? So this is the so-called differential of democracy. This is a term that probably you're familiar with, that comes from the automotive sector. That's a device that basically enables the wheels of a vehicle to, in a way, flow into one individual movement, which is the driving movement of the car, of the vehicle. And back then, it was political parties which were capable to envisage common expectations and common ideals, to envisage the work towards a common good. And this brought together the expectations. This was a reply to the expectations of millions of people. Today's democracies have lost this differential. Individualized lives have themselves turned themselves into expectations or requests for individual rights. And another phenomenon has taken place. I'm talking about the growth of people's liberties, individual liberties. This growth of individual liberties has been considered as the growth of the liberties for the person. Also, when it comes, but does this apply to everybody's expectations and needs, or also for the rights and for the common good towards which one's personal life and the life of one's relatives has to be devoted to? This was the question at the beginning of this century. And if I were to reply to this question, I think that the then Cardinal Ratzinger contributed a lot. I think we owe him a lot for delving so deep into this topic. Nearly 20 years ago, he entertained a dialogue with Jürgen Habermas, a philosopher, a non-believer, and both of them agreed on the fact that a society that is experienced and lived only as a society of individuals would not survive, would not be able to survive, because it doesn't have the connective fabric that is needed for something to be built and for things to be maintained and not destroyed, for example, by conflicts between the various rights and the various liberties. They both came to the conclusion that everybody, believers and non-believers, believers in different religions, everybody had a common task, that is the task of finding values that could be shared by everybody, that could be common by everybody, and that could serve as a solid platform on which the present and the future of societies could be based. I very much support this idea, because I've devoted much of my life to the Cortile dei Gentili. That's an institution that was created based on this idea. This was an idea proposed by Benedict XVI. I've been working on this for years. And for years, together with other people, I am witnessing that common views, common assessments, common evaluations stem between this dialogue, from this dialogue between believers and non-believers. Platforms to address difficult aspects have been created, for example, to address topics like the end of people's lives. And thanks to patience, through mutual respect, and without extremizing one's ideas, we have seen that Ratzinger and Habermas were right. Faith and the values stemming from the civilization of human beings could enable to recognize that the individual comes before the state, that the person is not only an individual, and that people have a freedom that presupposes the freedom of the others, and that if you have the right to fulfill your life's dream, still it is possible that also the project, the life's projects of other people can be part of your life project, and that you have to consider everything all together. So, rights and duties.
Participation and solidarity. Christianity can really, be a basis that it's more adequate than other religions to, act with tolerance, with the right comprehension. Because these are the main values of the Declaration of Rights on which our civilization is based and has been based at least after Second World War. All women and men were made equal in terms of dignity and rights. If these words have a meaning, if the Universal Declaration of Human Rights of 1948 makes sense and has a sense, a meaning, this means that this mutual recognition of rights is a common good that allows everyone to be part of what is made, created together. Subjectivism stops where the, let's say, reasons, the motives of others start, but stops in front of truths, and the truths that the life imposes to each one of us. It is not true that it's not, that it's possible to have one's own moral and ethical principles. We need to be brave enough to say that there are truths that make distinctions between what is fair and unfair, and we need to be brave enough to stop those who overdo. In the long history of humanity, of mankind, the pillars of Hercules have moved but still exist. And so let me conclude by saying that all believers and non-believers should know that, we are all creatures on this planet and we are all responsible for defending what has been created and not destroying it for the good of those who will come after us. And so, truths also include the truths that stem from science and knowledge. Denying these truths would mean to really get into what is false and not fair. This is a very abstract principle, at least apparently. But there is an example that we can give. Two parents that have been convinced that only homeopathy can treat their children that maybe are ill, and that totally reject any other kind of medical treatment proposed by other doctors, well, the two parents are not doing what is good for their creature, because they are believing something that is false and unfair, and following what is false made them make a decision that is not fair for their creature. So these are the basis of what I'm about to say to answer the other questions that Vittadini asked at the very beginning. We are faced with a very demanding task, a challenging one, maybe the most challenging that mankind has had to deal with in its long history on this planet. This task requires mankind to ensure, to make sure that other people survive, that people survive, that there is the survival of your children and of your children's children. Major changes will be needed to stop the current trend, the current trend is something that climatologists defined as, well, you know, this summer as being the colder or the cooler summer of the next years. Those who are experts in this say that we don't have the solutions. We are just, gain time for technology to give us something that we haven't found yet. Changes in the energy that we use, changes in our everyday lives that also require to make adjustments, to adapt to new rules of lives that everyone will need to abide by. But these changes will be major, crucial, and will be at the basis of what we will be able to do to govern, in a way, this giant phenomenon, a phenomenon that we have already experienced with the pandemic and that was symbolized by the face mask. And this is something that we need to do to have the good tomorrow, because there are things that can work only if we all abide by the rules, if we all comply with the rules, not just some, you know, categories of people, some groups of people, but everyone. Everyone needs to respect the rules, to comply with the rules. That's what happened with the face masks when we were, you know, meeting each other. Well, either we all wore a mask, we were all wearing a mask, or it was useless. How can a democracy guarantee that these rules are observed by everyone? Shall we call the police? Shall we sanction the non-compliance? Well, yes, sometimes, but not every time that a rule is violated. This is not something that democracy can do as other authoritarian regimes do. Otherwise, it won't be a democracy anymore. Or, well, it would mean that there are some unavoidable rules that made us renounce to democracy and, choose some more authoritarian regime. here we need to implement something that is specific, that is the core of democracy. We pursue common good because we are convinced of it, and not because we are obliged to do it. We are not empathic. We do not want solidarity because we are obliged to. And we go back to the starting point of democracies, democracies for millions of human beings. How can we generate this idem sentire that is shared by millions and millions of people? You know that I don't want to make politics, or at least have to do with politics, considering my role at the Constitutional Court. But I have high regard for the people who do politics. However, I cannot but observe that due to the reasons that led to the liquid society that I mentioned earlier on, and that in some cases replaced it with some, you know, aggregations that are based on ideas that are too strict, if you think of the United States and what is happening. Well, this said, I think that politics is not equipped enough, let's say, to face the problems and the challenges had. Maybe the parties of the past would have been strong enough to convince their followers and make them convince other people to take action. And maybe the parties of the past would have been strong enough to set this primary goal, that is, aiming for one common good. Nowadays, this is not the case anymore. This is not what happens anymore. There is a structural fragility in politics. And this makes politics follow and not drive, not lead. It is clear that electors have questions, and these questions are plausible. But there is this internal, inner fragility of politics that doesn't allow politics to, you know, lead people towards the future. Should we renounce to the future for this reason? No, absolutely not. If this is a real democracy with the values that I mentioned, believing in these values, where solidarity, the value of people, still has meaning, well, if this is true, but politics is not enough, we need to be able to admit it and, you know, use all the resources available to achieve that common good. And everyone is a resource for this purpose. So, to sum up and wrap up what I've said so far, how can we do that? Giovanni Soldini, champion that you all know and that we have seen going around on his sailing boat around the world. Well, maybe we should do something similar to what he did, and maybe mitigate what we are seeing in the world. But this is something that science should tell us. science should tell us, because we do not have the right tools, the cognitive and knowledge tools that and knowledge, sorry, that we need. It's up to science to tell us the road to follow, the path to follow. However, we need to have the right credibility so that the political institutions can show us the different ways to follow based on the teaching, the messages of science as well. I expect science to have some specific behaviors, some, you know, behaviors that are more sober, maybe simpler than what we were somehow used to seeing and hearing during the pandemic. We cannot have the same kinds of behaviors that we had during the pandemic. Otherwise, we would reduce the credibility of science, because science should not be monolithic. Science makes mistakes. This is clear. But we need to have the professional approach by people who work hard in science and who, you know, takes the distance with those who are actually talking about what is not true but only realistic. Science should tell us which way to follow and be responsible for, you know, the people who need to trust what science has said. And political institutions should be downstream working to convince people for this task to be performed. And this task is not only up to politics, it is up to everyone, to all of us. And this is where volunteers and voluntary work comes to my mind. When I was a young member of a party, there were millions of volunteers. Now there are only 700,000, and they are generally related to public institutions. But there is something that has more than 4 million members so far, and there are volunteers among these members, and this allows to reach another 30, 40 million people. And this is the kind of resource that we need to have, that we need to harness in a way. This is the example that we need to give. And this is the driver of this action for convincing people that we need. There was a debate a few months ago, and I asked volunteers to be involved in politics, and you didn't want to do it because you didn't want to be, let's say, used as a tool, as a means to achieve something. However, I would like to renew that invitation and, you know, invite not all volunteers, because otherwise we would have more than 5 million members in the among politics, let's say. But again, there's something which is part of the voluntary work, that is talking to other people, being with other people, and deciding together with other people what should be done. This is like the, you know, the lungs of democracy. And this is what the world should be. And this is the kind of responsibility that we should take in the future. And then there are young people, you, the young people who are here in this room. The Republic has some tasks based on the Constitution, and these tasks should be performed for the good of the future generations. And this is a good thing, but you would need to guarantee that this happens. We need human beings ensuring that this happens, and you are those who need to guarantee and make sure that this happens. And let me conclude by saying that, as you have noticed, even though I'm old, I'm still working, I'm still functioning, so to say, and I will try to be as close as I can to you on this way that you are following, because you represent our future, the future.
Thank you very much, Mr. President. Your comments as President of the Italian Constitutional Court are remarkable. That's the first time that a President of the Constitutional Court comes to the Romanian meeting. And what you have said is giving us the framework within which we are called upon to work. You have shown us that whatever happens in terms of work for the other, starting from an idea of truth, corresponds today with renewed institutions. Cardinal Zuppi yesterday and you today have shown how fundamental it is in terms of our work. And so personal commitment, personal work is not something utopian, but it rather corresponds to the setting up of a new society. And this is what we would like to do, also with the parties whose representatives are going to participate in the Romanian meeting. We would like to do this also in all the places where we are present to serve the others. Don Giussani, Father Giussani told us that serving the others is the most important thing to do. And serving the others today is not only for us and to our reality, but it's an action in favor of the community where we live, of the people where we live. So thank you very much once again, Mr. President. We will certainly take advantage of what you have taught us.
Civiltà dell'amore, fratelli e sorelle, costruite senza stancarvi mai questa civiltà. Lavorate per questo, pregate per questo, soffrite per questo. We'll be right back.
aspettavano così.
Perché credo in quello che dico.
Questo e basta?
Sì.
Giussani ha generato un popolo e io faccio parte di questo popolo.
L'avvenimento in cui Dio entra nella nostra esistenza e tutti, colpiti da una curiosità, sospendono un istante l'ora e guardano dalla parte da cui viene il grido.
Aspettavano così.
Perché credo in quello che dico.
Questo e basta?
Sì.
Don Giussani ha generato un popolo e io faccio parte di questo popolo.
L'avvenimento in cui Dio entra nella nostra esistenza